provision, and usually I'm the kind of person when I speak, I do a lot of hand stuff. You know, but today I'm gonna be silent down just a little bit with the microphone here. But if you cannot hear me anything during this time, you just raise your hand and I will try and come back to the mic and you can, will be able to hear me. It is a joy to be here with you today. My name is Joel Wilson, in case you do not know me or anything. I'm one of the elders here at the church. I'm not the pastor. I'm Pastor David is away taking some R&R, which I believe all pastors should do, because he's a man Jesus, but Jesus said, you need to come aside. You gotta take a break. So he is getting his battery recharged today. I want to ask you if you will turn with me in your Bible to 1 John chapter 1. We're going to stand up here, if you'll do that now, and we're going to read God's Word together. We're going to honor Him as we listen to the Scriptures. You may have it on an iPhone or Android or any way you can get to a copy of it. Let's read in 1 John chapter 1, verses 1 through 10. Verse 1 says to us, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked on, and our hands have handled, considering the word of life. This life was manifested, we have seen it, and bear witness, and show to you that eternal life, which was with the Father, and was manifested to us. That which we have seen and heard, we are declaring it to you, that you also may have fellowship with us, and truly our fellowship is with the Father, and with His Son, Jesus Christ. And these things we write to you, that your joy may be full. This, then, is the message which we have heard of Him, and declare to you, that God is light, and in Him is no darkness at all. If we say we have fellowship with Him, and walk in darkness, we lie, and do not do the truth. But if we walk in the light, as He is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, His Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins, and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make Him a liar, and His word is not in us. Thank you, and I want to ask you just to continue to stand just for a moment. I want to ask you to pray, and then I want you to participate in this prayer with me today and say, Lord God, Lord Jesus, Heavenly Father, would you please speak to my heart today and speak to the person who's next to me and say, I want to leave today, Lord, with something new that will help me in my walk with you. So let's pray. And Heavenly Father, thank you for our gathering today. Thank you for our fellowship with you, with one another. We pray today that that would increase as we explore the truth of your word and we look into it and we gather not only just information, but we gather, Father, conviction that will lead to transformation in our life. So we ask you, Lord Jesus, and I ask you as the one who's bringing this, to speak to my heart. I ask you to speak to everyone's heart who's around me today. Lord, we open our spirit, our heart, our mind, everything so that we can hear from you. And as we hear from you, thank you for giving us grace to obey you. Thank you for giving us the power of your spirit, Lord Jesus, when we are absolutely powerless and cannot change only through his power and through the truth of your word. Lord, we look for your leadership. Thank you for helping us to lead transformed. It's in your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. The title of today's message is Keeping My Relationship with God Fresh. And that's I want you to leave here today knowing how to do that. Let me ask you for a couple of inventories here today. How is your relationship with God right now? Better yet, let's make it means walking in fellowship with God is really what we're trying to say. Because your relationship, if you're born again and you've just trusted Jesus Christ as your Savior, it's not going to change. Because what God started something in you, and according to Philippians chapter 1, verse 6, God who began it didn't work, you know what? He's going to finish it. My salvation is not dependent upon what I do, or what I have not done, or what I'm going to do. My relationship is totally dependent upon God's work in my life, through my life, because He is faithful and He is going to complete the process. I cannot become unsaved. I cannot lose my salvation, and the most important thing, God cannot lose me. He knows exactly where you're at this very day, this very moment. He knows each trial, each circumstance, each hardship, each triumph. He knows exactly where you're at, and He wants your relationship with Him to be fresh. Now, I'm going to ask you for a little participation today out there. When I say the word fresh, what word comes to your mind? Anybody just care to speak up? Anyone else in the fresh? When I say fresh, this boat kill? No, no, no. What is it?
Good.
Good, okay. Anybody else? Okay.
Renewal.
Is there anything like any kind of food that comes to your mind when you thought the word fresh? Oh. Oh, bread, okay. What I think of fresh, the food I often think of is what? A nice, big, peeling those avocados and many things in them, and finally a nice chip and that's fresh. Any other thing come to your mind about fresh? Okay. Good. So yeah, that put that little concept in your mind. You know, we want to keep our relationship with God fresh. And that will, whatever you think fresh is, that will kind of help you relate to where we're trying to get to. So how do you keep your relationship with God fresh? It's very simple. You walk in fellowship with God. Let's read 1 John 1, 3 and 4 and see what God has to say to us. John said, let me start right here. Before this, John wants you to know something. He said, what I'm sharing with you today, and what he said, I'm sharing with these people in this epistle, it is not hearsay. It is based upon a real historical person. It is based upon a relationship that I had with him. He said, I have seen him. I have touched him. I know him. He has spoken to me. He said, he is not some phantom. He's not some ideology. But he is a real person. And he is who he says he is. He is the living Son of God. Therefore, he said, you can know that what I'm telling you, I'm passing over to you, he said, is truth from God. In verse 3, he said, that which we have seen and heard, we're declaring to you, that you may have fellowship with us. So he's saying, I want to have that common element with you, saying truly our fellowship is with the Father and with His Son, Jesus Christ. When Jesus came to earth, He revealed the Father to people. And Jesus said in the Gospel, in John chapter 14, 15, 16, which by the way, if you study those, you'll find they are the truth, and they open up all the Pauline epistles for you to understand them, and you study them. Jesus said, at that day, said, after I'm resurrected, the Holy Spirit has come, said, you will know that I am in you, and that I am in the Father, and that you are in me. He said, you're going to have a relationship with the Father. He said, your relationship and your fellowship is going to be so close with Him that anything you ask in my name, I will give it to you. Wow, boy, that's tremendous. Does that mean that every time that I come to God and I ask something, it's like a blank check? The answer is no, that's not what it means. To ask in somebody's name is like saying, let me ask and I'm representing all that your son is, all his intention, all his power, all his goodwill, everything that he wants from me, I want to ask what and it will be done. Scripture also tells us, we can ask him sometimes, and we do it. We ask amiss. It says, consume it upon our own lust, our own desires. God says, ask in my name, and what I will give it to you. So we have an open relationship with him and with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. When I think of the word fellowship, what comes to your mind? Well, if your fellowship could be, when you're gathered around the TV, what the Cowboys score? Said, it was an impossible to play. And everybody went, yeah. Of course, there's probably one Steelers fan somewhere going, holdovers in it. But that's okay. You know, we love them too. So, but when you have fellowship, what it brings you together in camaraderie and oneness. We have fellowship with God. We are what enjoying a oneness relationship. We are free in His presence. There is nothing hidden in our life from Him. We enjoy Him. And only a person who is born again knows what that means. One person said, well, you know, that's how it was when I was first saved. Boy, God's presence is so real. Said, but I don't understand what's happening right now. Said, is God moved? And my answer is, no, guess who moved? It wasn't God. Mm-hmm. But it was you. But God is wanting to do something. If you're a new Christian, He will do what I call, He will wean you from your feelings. Because just like a newborn infant, you know, they need to feel that their parents are there. You know, and if they leave the room, they back up what happened, and they're looking for you. They're expecting you. But they have to learn how to trust you. God is doing that if you are a new believer or you're beginning to walk with God. He may take those feelings away so that He will drive you to His Word and you'll learn to take Him at His Word and just simply trust Him to do what He says He will do and to be who He says He will be. Trust in Him. That is what fellowship is about. John says the goal of our kind of fellowship is that he says that the things are written that your joy may be full. Did you know that Jesus had joy going to the cross? Even realizing all that was set before Him, He said, my joy what is full. You can have actual joy in your life no matter what your circumstances are, how tough it is out there, how much conflict you're going through. We can have His genuine joy on us. You see, happiness is what dependent upon what my circumstances, but joy is dependent upon what my fellowship with God. So, if I am not experiencing joy in my life during what's going on in my life, there's something and I need to make some adjustments in my life. My relationship is absolutely certain. I need to make something. I need to move the right direction. Aren't you glad that He said to us, I will never leave you nor forsake you? Boy, I've been there sometimes. God, where are you at in all this? I don't see you. But then again, I come back to His promise. I will never leave you nor forsake you. So if we'll look at our next slide here. I want to give you three suggestions that I believe that we can learn in the rest of this chapter. Is that we're having fellowship with God, having a fresh relationship with us. I believe it means three things are taking place in your life. Number one, it means that we are rightly dealing with sin in our life. Number two, we are righteously preparing for temptation. And number three, we are regularly believing, affirming the promises of God. If you practice these three things, I can promise you on the authority of God's Word that you will enjoy fellowship with Him and your relationship with Him will stay fresh. It's like when I leave here today, boy, I'd love to have that bowl of guacamole. It's fresh. No, don't know if that'll happen or not, but I'm still looking for something that's fresh. And there's no temple we need to go to. So let's look at rightly dealing with sin in our life. In verse 5, he says, this then is the message that we've heard of Him and declaring to you that God is light, and in Him is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with Him and walk in darkness, what we lie. We do not do the truth. But if we walk in the light as He is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, His Son, cleanses us from all unrighteousness. Well, rightly or wrongly sin, first of all, we must understand what God is like. It does not say God was like, God is becoming God. God is present tense. He is light. Mm-hmm. Have you ever been blinded by headlights? Yeah, many times. Yeah, it hurts your eyes. You know, we think that hurts your eyes. God's light is so bright, it said that no person can even stand in it. It would totally consume you. So what then is light? Light, I believe, is simply the revelation of who God is in His character, all that He is, and He wants you to know about Himself. So there is no unending end of life. God is life. He's continuing to be that, and He's unending. You cannot fully know Him. We will spend all eternity with Him. He is a creature, or He is a person who is not bound by time, space, or anything. And I believe God's life always also has a physical reality and a spiritual reality to it. We read in Genesis chapter 1, the darkness was on the face of the deep, and what? Then God said, let there be light. Because there is light. Now, when we think about darkness, or walking in darkness, as we suggest here in our text, you know, that's a tragic thing. And maybe you've been across cavern, across that cavern. You know, they turn out the lights. Anybody ever been there? Yeah. You know, that's dark. God says, you know, says, I am light. He says, but what? You can walk in darkness. What is darkness? Darkness is what my walking in my old self will, my old selfish desire. I'm walking apart from where and what I know God wants me to do. I know better. But what I've chosen what to enjoy sin for a season, and God says the wickedness of sin never changes. It is always death. So there's always pleasure in sin for a season. What? But it always leads to death. Always leads to what? Distress. God wants us to walk with Him in the light. Let me tell you a story about walking in darkness. You know, that may help us understand a little bit. Once there was a farm boy, and he had a girlfriend named Betsy. And they liked to sneak off to the barn. And this happened a long time ago. And so one night, Betsy said, hey, Josh, why don't we sneak off to the barn? And so I don't know what went on in the barn. I'm not sure. Betsy, you know, she's a little bit mischievous, and she snuck off and she went to the barn. And so Josh said, you know, I think I'm going to go check on things out at the barn, Dad. And so, being the young man he was, he didn't take a lantern with him. But, you know, he knew how to walk to the barn. So Josh opened the door, walked to the barn, then he started hearing some giggling, and then all of a sudden, you know, he felt a warm breath, and then out of nowhere, this big, slurpy tongue licking. And he said, you know, Betsy, where are you? And his cow responded. And he learned that walking in darkness will get you. And it was a very moving experience, as you can imagine. I promise. So that is what walking in darkness is. It's like walking across that cavern. It's walking separated from God. But the good news is, what? I can be cleansed by the blood of Jesus Christ. The word cleanse actually means this. I can be so fully white clean, there is no evidence, no taint, no stain. It looks as if nothing had ever happened. That's the good news. You know, God is not keeping a ledger like this, or like we think of a ledger. But God said, you know, once I've forgiven you, and said, I've wiped you all away, and so I just need to kind of do this to it. He said, and every time you confess your sin, said, my son looks and says, I have paid the full price for that. And God said, I see, he's been forgiven. Well, that's good news. There is no sin too great. There's no sin too small. There's no thing too horrendous that God cannot forgive. And when he forgives, what does he do? He cancels your debt. So that's part of what walking in light and not darkness is about. Are you walking in any darkness in your life today? Are there things in your life that you know that don't belong there? Things that you should be turning away from? And you say, I really know I should make an adjustment. I need to come to the light. Well, you know, the good thing about light, you can't walk in light because what does light do? What? It always reveals things. It always reveals the darkness. A friend of mine, who's a seminary president, was going to another seminary, and they said, well, you know, this seminary has had some kind of liberal tendencies at the time. Said, what are you going to do? Are you going to fire all the professors who don't agree with you? He said, oh, no. He said, I'm not going to do that at all. He said, I'm just going to turn on the light and watch the roaches fly. And so, I said, yeah, I know that feeling. I've lived in Houston, Texas. I know what it means when the roaches go this way and that way. So that is what, you know, turning the light can happen. So turn the light and not the darkness. Come, you know, to the light and let reveal things to you. What, because what? You can't hide from God. It's like the little child sometimes we are. Says, God, you don't see me, do you? No, that's the game that Adam played. God, now you see me, now you know. Guess what? Yeah, he sees everything. So you might as well come to the light and do what he says, let him cleanse you from all sin. Now, the tragic thing is sometimes in verse 8, Christians do this. If we say to him of sin, what we deceive ourselves and what the truth is not in us. Some people actually believe, you know, that what I am so perfect, I'm getting so Christ-like, and he says, there's nothing. I'm just okay. No, I never met a growing Christian who is not struggling and God is not revealing to them something new that they needed to work on or grow their relationship, their fellowship with him rather than the sin of their life. But as the person who thinks, you know, they've got it all together, and then God, what he will allow you to make sure that you understand who he is and what he says he will do. He will allow in your life an opportunity for you to come back to him, come back to life, get cleansed, what, and admit, Lord, apart from you, and I'm a fallen sinner. I can't do anything without you. I need the power of your spirit in my life. So, if you know someone around you, you say, well, yeah, I'd really like to have fellowship with them. I'd like to have more fellowship. Well, do what number B says there. It says, B-B-B-W-M-B-G-I-N-F-Y. Said, what in the world is that word? Did you just know that stands for, please be patient with me because God is not finished yet. John is going to suggest something to us a little bit later on in chapter 2. He's going to tell us what the number one problem of darkness is and what Christians walk in the Christian church. He said, if we hate our brother, what, we walk in darkness and we don't do the truth. And well, I don't hate anybody. You know, hate is my young son saying, that's a strong word. But you know what, it is having ill will towards somebody. If someone, you know, I don't get along with, and I will go and gossip behind their back, or I will talk badly about them. No, that's a form of hate. God says if we are really forgiving one another and we're wanting to have fellowship with one another, well, we'll be patient with each other. This is especially what true in our home. Because sometimes it takes a long time to change. Old habits don't change overnight. So let me encourage you, be patient. Because what? God is not finished with me yet, neither is he finished with you. One day, he said, you will be totally Christ-like. You will not be Christ himself, but you will have his character in your life. In fact, I believe you literally to the millennium, you know, we'll have a new body, new heart, and everything. What, and we will not sin anymore. Wow, I can't imagine what that's like, you know, to have absolutely never having to deal with sin in my life again, but, you know, I probably have to deal with it around us. So please be patient. So what else do we do to learn how to deal with sin? As we sin, we learn how to practice 1 John 1:9. 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, what, God is faithful and just to forgive us from all unrighteousness and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. First, forgive our sins. If you do not want to confess your sins, what, you cannot experience the forgiveness of God. When we get forgiveness, it is the same word that they use for canceling out the debt. It is something that we owe to God everything to obey him fully, completely, and wholly. And when we don't want, we incur a sin debt with him. It's already paid for judicially, but what God says, I need to experientially allow you to confess what and experience what I have purchased for you. Full forgiveness. He says that if we confess, how long has it been since you confessed your sin to God? Week, month, day, hour? I found that the saints, I believe, who walk closest with God are constantly in a habit pattern of, God, I see that's displeasing you. I need some Lord. The attitude is wrong. This is those words I should not have spoken. They are constantly sensitive to confess their sin to God. Because if that confession is not going on, well, they'll be walking in darkness. They will not be walking in the light. The word confess there is a simple word. It means what? Homo legeo, which means to say the same thing as God says about sin. Sometimes when we confess our sin, what we want to give God an excuse. And God says, sorry, no excuses allowed. There are no God and but, they, there's no buts in there whatsoever. Confess says, God, I see this from what you see it as. I want to call it exactly what you call it, and I want to deal with it exactly as brutally as you have to deal with it. I want to choose what not to walk in it anymore. But if we confess, say it's the same thing God says, what He is what? Faithful and just, forgive us our sins, and it cleanses from all unrighteousness. Don't you like that? He said, He is faithful. It is a present tense. He's going to keep on keeping on being faithful to you. What? Because what? I have a relationship with Him that cannot be broken. I have fellowship with Him that's always available to me. And He is just because what? Jesus has paid the full price. Now, you can go free. I heard a story recently one time of a judge who said, you know, a guy was brought to him because of his indebtedness. Earlier that day, a man had come to the judge and said, you know, I want you to prosecute this man because what he has stolen money from me. He said, but what I'm going to do, he said, he needs to pay a fine because he's done some other things that are illegal. He said, well, I'm going to go ahead and pay his fine. So when he comes before you and he confesses to you what is wrong, said, I want you to tell him fully forgiven, all debts have been paid. And that is exactly what happened. He was just in doing it because what someone else had paid. I am so glad God is so faithful. But He can never not unforgive me. There's nothing too horrendous, nothing wrong, but everything can be forgiven. And He will cleanse us from what? All unrighteousness. And when He says all, He means what? All unrighteousness. Anything that is not conforming to His will, His purpose, His character, or walking in the light. So, we know how to rightly deal with sin in our life. Before you leave here today, and you think about your fellowship with God, and a fresh relationship with Him, let me encourage you, what you think through this, what and confess to God, what needs to be confessed. Come to the light. Stay in the darkness. Follow Him. Well, let's look at our next slide there. We also, thinking about sin, is that we're, as a Christian, what God says to us in Romans chapter 6, what? God says, what shall we say? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? And His word says to us, God forbid. How shall we dare then to sin living in any longer? You shouldn't be there. God does not expect us. He says, well, I'm going to say, I'm going to confess it in the cycle. He wants you, what, to stop sinning. Stop it. And God says, yes, I will stop it. Stop playing games. No, don't say, God, I need to. You have to make up your mind. Choose to stop sinning. 1 Corinthians 10:13 tells us that there is no temptation taking you, but it is such as common man, but God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted above what you're able, but will of every temptation make a way of escape, that you may be able to endure it. In other words, God is saying, well, everybody else is being tempted just like you. You're no isolated case. So we all have like passions, like desires. There's no one who is immune to this and that. Said, but what? Temptation ones come to everyone. But what? God is faithful. Oh, there's another faithful. He will not allow you to be tempted above what you're able. So if I sin, what? Guess what? I have chosen the wrong thing. I chose darkness instead of light. But what He is able, what? To keep you from sinning. And He will help you, what? To endure it. God expects us to want to develop endurance in Christian life. When an athlete is conditioning and is training himself, what does he have to do? He has to, what? Go with endurance. He has to build endurance in his life. My high school football coach had an interesting way of developing endurance in us. At the beginning of every August, about mid-August, he would get a school bus, and this is a small rural town, and he would get out the whole team, you know, all 28 of us on the bus, and he would take us 3 miles outside of town. And he would dump us. And he said, you know, you all have to run back all 3 miles. He said, I know you slackers have been slacking off during the summer. He said, but the last one in has to get back on the bus, and they have to do it all over again. So he would be there, Coach Dale would. You know, he was a guy that played pro ball for 15 years. He was a tough on us high school guys. And he would turn on his emergency flashers, going down there on that country highway, and he would be honking his horn, blowing his whistle, standing in the doorway, yelling, run! Run! You better run! He said, how are you going to be in the fourth quarter? You better run! He'd scream. And when he blew, we got him. He hardly, and he was always looking at us, who's last? Who's last? Well, 3 years in a row, it was good old George Henry. And he said, Henry's last. And he had screamed and said, Henry, back on the bus! He said, the rest of you, take a break. So he'd take him back in the morning. Henry would, he could hardly walk when he got there. You know, who was the important player in the fourth quarter? Who did he put in? You know, when he needed an emergency, he put Henry in. Well, because Henry endured, he understood what it means. So God wants us to develop some endurance. How do you develop endurance in the Christian life? By staying in fellowship with Him, by staying by walking the truth of His Word and walking in the light. You develop what spiritual muscle, practicing the truth. And well, by stopping it. Just simply say, Lord, whatever my temptation is, thank you, what is common to men, thank you that you are enabling me now through the power of your Spirit to say no. So I will say no. And I'm going to, sometimes, in some cases, get out of here, believe the place. Move, just like Joseph in Genesis, when Pharaoh, I mean, his master's daughter, or wife, was tempting him. So we looked at, you know, there's no temptation taking such as common man to stop it. Let me ask you this. Are you embracing, praying, and living out the truth of Romans 6? If you have not read that chapter, I believe it is probably, outside of John 15, the most important chapter for the Christian life. That and probably third, or it's kind of hard to expect to finish Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 6 says, what shall we say? Shall we continue in sin? And God says, God forbid. He said, we were baptized into Christ, we died in sin, but we can walk in newness of life. He says, count yourself to be dead to sin, the life of God. Don't let sin reign in your mortal body, it's your sin, but it is lust. Don't yield your members sin, instruments of righteousness. Rather, yield yourselves unto God. And your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. Yeah, instruments of righteousness are not only our hands, our feet, but I believe our mouth, our eyes, everything about us. Whenever temptation comes, just stop and say, God, thank you right now. I want to pray to you. Thank you, Father. I could sin, but I don't have to. I'm free. The blood of Jesus Christ, your Son, has cleansed me from all sin. It keeps on cleansing me. Thank you that I'm now free to make you walk in the light as you in the light. So we righteously want prayer for temptation, just as we want know that we need to rightly deal with sin in our life. So that leads us to our next slide, answer number 3, which is what we regularly or believingly and affirming with the promises of God through prayer and practice. I know how to deal with sin, I know how to deal with temptation. Every day, I believe a growing Christian, you need to affirm things before God. I think of some of you today, you're going through life changes, not having shifts in your life. You're looking, God, what is my next step? Well, just look at some of these things that you can practice every day. I do these myself every day. I've learned about the power of thanksgiving in our life. How can I give thanks in the midst of difficulties and things that don't seem right in my life? Seem wrong, I can give thanks because I understand God's superintendence over all the affairs of my life. I understand what He is in control. Why does He allow bad things to happen to good people? Because what He wants to display things in your life and how you respond in your relationship with Him and others so they can know about more of His character. God says, you know, there is a divine drama going out here. What angels are watching you, people are watching you, said, I want to display who I am, that through your weakness, they can tell how strong I am in your life. Isn't it good to realize that when you can reach that point in your life and say, God, there is no other explanation for my life other than that you are. Philippians 2, 12 through 13 says, just it said, as you obey, says, work out your own salvation. It said, for it is God who works in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. I begin the morning by saying, God, thank you for helping me to work out my salvation and your plans for my life today. I believe you, Lord, thank you that it is you who is what? Working in my life, both to will and to do your good pleasure. And because you're working, I know that you're going to lead me and I can have fellowship with you. I can walk in the light as you're in the light. So for this sake, thank you, Lord, for your plans. I'm not working for my salvation because I cannot earn it. I don't have to pay the price. But Lord, I'm working it out. Sometimes it's difficult. It's hard. You don't see, you know, what's around the next corner, but God knows every next step that you need to make. We look at another great promise of God in Romans 8:28. There are issues going on in my wife and I's life right now, not between us personally, that we're looking at and seeing possible in our life. And I often I'll say, Lord, I want to thank you today that you're working all things together for good in my life. Yes, what is that good? God says in the next verse, said that good is what's conforming you to the image of his son. That's what the good is in your life. God is working them out through a salvation plan for your life, and he is working all things together for good. It's hard to see sometimes, but it takes a long time. And then God will work in your life, and that all during that time of preparation, and all of a sudden God's supernatural supply will come forward in your life. Let me tell you a story about Frederick the Great. Maybe you've read about him in the history book, but he is a very benevolent, very kind king. One day he was going through the prison house, and they knew that the king could immediately pardon anyone just by waving his hand. And so he went to each prison, all nine prison cells. He asked each man, he said, tell me, man. And instantly, eight men got on their knees. And began to say, oh, king, we are innocent. Oh, king, we are innocent. But the man in the ninth cell said, oh, king, he said, I am most guilty. He said, I have committed burglary. I have stolen from people. He said, and I deserve my sentence. And the king looked at the jailer and he said, the man in cell number nine, the ninth cell, said, let that man go free. He said, and the jailer said, why? He said, because I'm scared that he'll contaminate all these innocent people in here. Wow, you know, that is, God has got to work all things together. Yeah, he works all things together for good. Verses 35 through 39, another great promise of God. He says, what shall separate us from the love of God? Shall tribulation, or famine, nakedness, or peril, or sword? And see, as it is written, we are killed all the day long. We're counting sheep for slaughter. It says, nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors to him that loves us. I'm persuaded in death, in our life, for angels, for principalities, for powers, for things present, for height, and depth, and anything to come, will we ever separate from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Wow. I love that. And I say, God, thank you for loving me. So that I don't deserve it, but I thank you that you did. Now, in return, what I can love others, just as our song said earlier, as he has loved me. I love the picture that the Apostle Paul is painting as he is writing to the Roman church. And if you understood the Roman culture, whatever a Roman general came in from conquering, and he brought with him slaves, he brought with him a booty, everything imaginable, you know, from looting the people whom he had conquered. And so Caesar would then call the general forward, and he would give him a parade. And he would put a title on the general, the conquering general, and they would ride around town in their chariots with all their entourage, everything that they had conquered with them, and it would say, more than a conqueror. The Apostle Paul said, what? We are more than conquerors. He said, through Christ Jesus our Lord. You know, we have a parade we can ride around, and people can see what? Not us, but we can see him who's conquered them, him who's given his life through his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. In Hebrews 12:6, we read, but without faith it is impossible to please God, for he that comes to God must believe that he is, and he is the rewarder of those who diligently seek him. often stop and say, God, thank you. I just want to seek you, and I thank you that you not were or are, but so forth. God is a rewarder. Lord, thank you for your reward. I don't know what it's going to look like, but you say you are a rewarder of those what we trust in you and we follow him. Then in Ephesians 2:10, he says, we are God's what workmanship created for good works. Now, which God has ordained that we should walk in before the foundation of the world. I just say, Lord, I don't know what all your directions are today, but I agree with you for the good works you want me to walk in today. Thank you. And I walk with you moment by moment, second by second, hour by hour, whether it's washing the dishes or whatever it is, Lord, I just want to do some good works to please you. But he will be faithful. He will walk you in the light as he is in the light. Can you see how light God's character is? God reveals who he is through his works to us. This is light you can walk in right now today. It's in Philippians. God, thank you. Help me work out my salvation. God, thank you that you're working all things together for good in my life. Thank you, Lord, that you love me. You're never, I'm more than a conqueror. There's nothing that can stand in my way in my relationship with you. You can say, Lord, thank you. I want to please you as you're going to reward me and that you have good works for me to walk in your name. Thank you, Lord. As we get the focus off of ourselves and get the focus on him, what our joy will become full. There are many, many other promises in God's word. You know, you will begin to confess them every day. But God will begin to help you line your life up. He will remove the darkness from your life. And you will enjoy a fellowship with him. And what the end result will be? Your relationship with him will stay fresh. So let's stop there today. I want you to bow your head, close your eyes. And I ask that no one look around or anything like this. I want to ask you a question today. Do you have a relationship with Jesus Christ for sure? Would you know this very second that if you were to die, you would be in his presence? Or maybe you're just simply not sure. Maybe you never made that decision in your life today. Could I just simply ask you, with no one looking around or anything, if you just simply slip up your hand and put it down right quick? You're in that condition today. And if you are, I want to ask you to pray this prayer. You can have a relationship with God if it comes through Jesus Christ. You can simply say, Lord Jesus, I believe that you died for my sins. I believe that you were resurrected from the dead. That your death paid a full penalty for my sin. I invite you into my heart as my Savior and Lord. Thank you for giving me eternal life and giving me a new life in you. You prayed that prayer and you turned to God with all your heart, soul, and your mind, what God will answer. Because belief in him involves, you know, confessing him as Savior and Lord. And if you haven't done that today, we have a card we'd ask you to fill out in the service. You can just check it off. No one's going to come to you. We'll send you a letter to remind you, help you understand what your next steps are. Maybe today is your day and you realize, Lord, I have been walking in darkness. I have not been walking in light. I need to do 1 John 1:9 today. I want to come back and freshen my relationship with you. If that's true, and I believe that God's Spirit is in you, he is pointing out to you so eloquently that you know what needs to be confessed to him today. Why don't you do what he says? Say the same thing he says. Call sin, sin. Don't offer excuse. Don't offer rationalization. Take full responsibility. Say, Lord, I confess this sin to you. Thank you for forgiving me and cleansing me. Thank you that you've canceled my debt. And now, Lord, I want to stop doing this sin right now. And I choose to reckon myself to be dead, to be alive to you. Thank you for giving me your resurrection power to change. I take you at your word and at your promise. And I want to prepare for temptation. I want to take all the right steps. Lord, I want to begin to line my life up with you today and say, thank you, Lord, for helping work out my salvation. Thank you, Lord, that your help in working all things together for good in my life, even though I can't see it all right now. I believe you. I trust you. Lord, thank you that you never leave me or forsake me. Thank you, Lord, that you have good works for me to walk in today. Thank you to help me to walk in there no matter how small, how great, how big, how little. Lord, I just want to please you, and that's my bottom line. So if you prayed that prayer today, you can leave here today, and you know that you've done this again. You can have a freshness in your life. You can begin to grow in his joy, as John tells us in verse 3 of 1 John 1. And the more you practice it, it says that your joy may be full. You will grow in it. And Father, I thank you for the truth of your word, that your word never returns to you void. It always accomplishes that which pleases you. Thank you for how you have worked in each one of our lives today, that we can have a fresh perspective and understand more and more what it means to walk in the light as you are in the light. And it's in your Son's, in Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Thank you. And I will be at the back door if you wish to talk to me.
Thank you, Dr. Joel. As the ushers are preparing to take our offering, we get back a portion that he has richly blessed us with so that we can further his work here and minister to others. There's a few announcements. 2 weeks from today,